earlier on, and then when I started looking up Martha Ellen's meaning of things, stuff like that, I felt like the Holy Spirit kind of redirected and to talk about light a little bit. In fact, I had I preached this message similar to this before, so I was looking at the notes, and at the top I had just written set a fire, and I took it off because I didn't remember why it was there. So, but then when the word came through Chandler about, you know, us being candles and the fire of God is going to light that candle, that's what it's, I thought, awesome, this is beautiful. What a great day to be living and be learning the things that we're learning and be open to the fire of God coming and lighting us up. Amen? What a great, awesome opportunity. So, you know, when I grew up, I was afraid of the dark. I was afraid of everything, actually, when I grew up. When I was little, I was afraid to sleep, I was afraid of the dark, I was afraid of scary movies, and, you know, everything. But, as a child of God, sometimes I see that same kind of fear in the church, that we're afraid of the dark, or the darkness. And I want to tell you that there is no reason for us to be afraid of the dark, or what's going on in the darkness. We don't have to be afraid of what's going on in the government. We don't have to be afraid of what's going on in the world. We don't have to be afraid of the new president, or the old president, or the new governor, or the old. We don't have to be afraid of anything that's going on in the darkness because of the light of Christ that's in us. So I want to talk about that a little bit because we're actually the ones that are supposed to be causing the disturbance in the powers of darkness. You know, Star Wars came out when I was a little kid, teenager, whatever, young teenager, I guess. And remember, you know, there's a disturbance in the Force, you know. Of course, I was running it over with Shannon. I was like, let me make sure I get this right here. He was saying there was a disturbance in the good Force, in the Force of light, right? Something bad had happened. And I think sometimes that's how we approach things as the church, is everyone knows something bad's happened. What are we going to do? We should never, ever feel that way. Once we realize, we sang a lot of songs this morning about who we are, and we can be who we are because of who Christ is. We should never feel powerless against the darkness. We are the ones that are supposed to be causing a disturbance in the darkness. When we shine the light, the darkness has to go. Yeah. It has no choice. So, as I grew up, I saw the church was afraid of a lot of things. They were afraid. Actually, my parents didn't want me to watch Star Wars because they were afraid it might teach some sort of wrong lesson or something like that. And then there were others you could probably think of. I won't name them. As different movies came and go and went, and the church is like, what's going to happen if somebody sees that movie? I think, Lord, help us. How powerless are we? You know, why is Hollywood more powerful than the church? It's not. But if we believe it is, then it becomes more powerful. We need to be shining the light that God has put in us. We don't have to be afraid of anything. The truth we preach and live is greater than any force, Hollywood or otherwise, that the world can come up with. Its power will always be the power of the darkness, the power in the world, whether it's Hollywood, whether it's the government, whether whatever it might be, is always a lesser power than the power of God in the church. Yeah. Just like Jim was talking about. He said, hey, go do your best, guys, do your best. Whatever power you've got, show it. Yeah. Because once you're done, I'm going to show you what real power looks like. That's the attitude we need to have as the people of God. When David faced Goliath, you know, they were all cowering. Oh, what are we going to do? This is a big guy. He's doing all this stuff. And he was like, are you kidding me? He's like, how dare you defy the people of God? That's our attitude because of what we carry and who we are. When the ecclesia comes together, there should always be a disturbance in the force of darkness. When a grandma is praying on her knees for her grandchildren, there's a disturbance in the force of darkness. It doesn't take some big powerful organization to do it. One person full of the Holy Spirit on their knees is making a difference. Any one of you can make a difference and disturb the power of darkness. But think about it, when we come together full of the Holy Spirit, when we're in one accord, the darkness is afraid of us. When a child is born with a destiny planned by Almighty God, there's a disturbance in the force of darkness. That's why I thought it was so cool when we were going to do a baby dedication today. I was like, something happened. Something. When a child is born and the Lord has a destiny for that child, and he's born into a family that are going to nurture that destiny in that child, the darkness gets afraid. But you know what it'll do? It'll lie to us and try to tell us, oh, no. And it'll come against that destiny. It'll come against those things. We don't even have to be afraid of that. Because greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. God is about disturbing things. You know, if you don't like to make waves, you might have misunderstood what you signed up for when you came into the church. We make waves. We disturb things. Not in a bad way. Not to just, you know, make people upset. But because of who we are, darkness is disturbed, and the darkness within them is disturbed. But once they see the light, then they get to come into the light, right? So it's okay to disturb the darkness. It's okay to ruffle some feathers in the world, because they just don't know any better. They're going to be ruffled. There's a disturbance in the force. Again, but this time it's a good thing. Because God is light. In him is no darkness at all. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. So as followers of God, as people who the Father has drawn into the kingdom, we become light in the world. James 1:17 says he's the Father of lights and doesn't even cast a shifting shadow. God's plan is light and life. In Genesis, he said, let there be light. So there was darkness all over the earth, right? We were talking about this a little bit on the way up here. The darkness all over the earth. I don't know the exact, we have to speculate about how it all happened. How did darkness even get there? You know, did Satan fall before? You know, all these things are all questions we could ask and try to come up with answers. But for whatever reason, there was darkness and it covered the earth, right? And what did God say? Let there be light. And you know what's interesting, you might have thought of this already, but he didn't say, let the sun shine until later. That was the fourth day. He didn't say, oh, let the stars shine their light. And the moon doesn't really have its own light. So he said, let there be light. And it says, and there was light. Because God is light. What he did is release himself into the atmosphere. I can just imagine, you know, when we're in heaven, I just feel like everything is going to be light. Like just everything is going to be light. We won't need any lights because everything is going to just sort of glow or something. And the Lamb is the light, right? And, you know, in the New Jerusalem, right? So I don't think we're going to need artificial light because everything's just going to be lit up. I don't think we're going to need to sleep, right? My wife is saying amen to that. She doesn't sleep very well. Here now. So he said, let there be light, and there was light. He saw that God saw that the light was good, and he separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and there was evening morning the first day. The light, what was he talking about? It wasn't natural light. Natural light is an agent, a natural agent that stimulates sight and makes things visible. Keep that in mind. It's natural light. Stimulates sight and makes things visible. Merriam-Webster, I looked this up online. It's electromagnetic radiation, natural light is. A wavelength that travels, and you can get into, you know, quantum theory and all that, science stuff. It's all very interesting. Difficult for me to understand fully. But it's radiation that's visible to the human eye. This is natural light. When he said, let there be light, he wasn't talking about natural light. talking about something else because the natural light wasn't there. The natural light he created later. It was supernatural light. Supernatural light is a supernatural, this is my own definition, I took it from the other one, supernatural agent that stimulates spiritual sight, making unseen visible. Just like Marcy was praying over Martha Ellen, that she's going to be a seer. She felt like the Lord was saying she's going to be a seer. You know, there's a lot of people that we run into now that are seers. They see things. They're like, oh, that's what's going on. And, you know, I believe that generally God wants us to see the unseen. Yeah. He wants us to see what the Father's doing. He wants us to see what he's doing in the supernatural realm. It's a very real realm. One of the things that God has been doing is kind of bringing leaders together in the South Jersey area to pray. And I don't want us to just react. And I don't want us to just pray, but it's a little different kind of prayer, I guess. I don't want us to just react to what's going on. I don't know if it's been happening up here. But down in South Jersey, especially last year, but it seemed like day after day after day, someone was overdosing on drugs and dying. Was that happening up here? Heroin overdoses like crazy. It was like, damn. And you know, we knew some of these. We knew some of them personally, and then some of them we knew because other people. And a lot of times what we do is we react to what has already happened in the natural. And we say, what can we do about that? And I think we should do that. We should respond in some way. Do something about things that are happening that way. But what I feel like the Lord is calling us to is a place of prayer where we see before these people die what is happening in that demonic realm. And what can we do to avoid those kinds of things? I believe the ecclesia is able to do that and should be doing that because of the light that we carry. Because that light that God released into the world is so we can see what's going on in the unseen realm. It's the glory of God. Habakkuk 2:12 says, "For as the waters fill the sea, the earth will be filled with the awareness of the glory of the Lord." The earth will be filled with the awareness of the glory of the Lord. How do we fill the earth with the glory of the Lord? Well, we carry the glory of the Lord in us. So when we fill the earth and we release the glory over the earth, it will be filled with the glory of the Lord and the awareness of the glory of the Lord. God, hey, we've got a powerful church in our community. Can you see what's going on over there? See what's happening? That coworker of mine, wow. You know, you want something done, ask her to pray for you. Ask him to pray for you. Because the glory of the Lord, they might not say it in those words, but the glory of the Lord is released through those things. So how did God begin to fill the earth with his glory? Obviously, he said, let there be light at the beginning, and then darkness seemed to, you know, he had to destroy the earth because it was so dark with a flood. And then it continued to get dark over and over again. And then he said, Zechariah prophesied just before Jesus was born in Luke chapter 1. It says, because of God's tender mercy, this is just part of the prophecy. Because of God's tender mercy, the morning light from heaven is about to break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death and to guide us to the path of peace. So when Jesus was introduced into the earth, he was bringing the light. He was bringing the kingdom. He was going to break forth into the darkness. John 1:1-5, and then verse 9 says, in the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. His life brought light to everyone. We know the scripture tells us that what Jesus did, we should do, right? Should our life be bringing light to the people around us? Sure it should. It says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Verse 9 says, the one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. Jesus was being introduced into the world that was full of darkness. Jesus' birth caused a great disturbance in the dark darkness. John 8:12 says, Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. He was introducing the light back into the world. 2 Corinthians 4:6, Paul wrote this to the Corinthians. He said, for God who said, let there be light in the darkness, thing I just said, has made his light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. Where is the light shining? In our hearts. Yeah, in us. It's shining in us. So that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. The light in us is also to cause a disturbance in the world, just like the light in Christ as he was introduced into the world. So how do we let our light shine? You say, oh, this little light, right? It's not a little light, by the way. If your light is little, it needs to be bigger. It needs to be like a fire that came down from heaven and consumed the altar and the sacrifice. Our light is not a little light. It's not a little tiny, it's nice to say little candle thing. It's not, we get it. It's still a candle will light up a dark room. But just think about it. When you're full of the power of the Holy Ghost, when you're full of the fire of God, you can literally change the atmosphere around. I know we throw that term around, but you can change the atmosphere when you walk into the room because of the light that you carry. It's a real thing.
Yes.
It's a very real thing that you carry. We've experienced it. I'm sure you've experienced it. If you haven't experienced it, you will experience it. Because when you come into a situation and people go, better when you're here. It's not about us as human beings. It's about the light that we carry. We've had people say, I'm just giving this as an illustration because it's what I know. We've had people say, you know, when you're around, I feel like it can do anything. You know, and it's because of the light that you carry. I'm sure that Jesus' disciples felt the same way. When he's here, we can do anything. Could just do anything when he's around. When he wasn't around, they couldn't quite do it, right? You know, he was up on the mountain and being transfigured and all that stuff with some of the disciples. The other disciples were down and they were trying to cast out a demon. They were like, we can't do it, right? When he's around, you feel like you can do anything. Well, he's around you all the time, right? And when you're around other people, they feel like they can do anything. Carry, causing a disturbance in the darkness. The thing that was making them feel a lack of peace is like it can't quite do its thing because you're carrying the peace of God with you. You're carrying the joy of the Lord. It's bringing strength into the situation. This is how you let your light shine. Matthew 5. Jesus is telling his followers, you are the light of the world, a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. He was declaring this over them. You are the light of the world. You can say this. I am the light of the world. I'm a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. Like if you feel like you're not making a difference, you need to declare these kinds of things over yourself. I am the light of the world. You work in a dark place. You work in an environment maybe that's not so great. Or maybe your home environment is not so great. You need to say, I am the light of the world. I'm a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. This isn't bragging. This isn't pride. This is declaring the word of the Lord over yourself so that the light that's in you can make a difference in the place that God's placed you. He said, no one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket. Instead, the lamp is placed in the stand where it can give light to everyone in the house. Let it shine. Let the power of God shine through you. Let the glory of the Lord shine through you. And it's not. It can be something as simple as a smile and being nice. Or it can be something as powerful as prophesying over them, bringing healing, or doing miracles. It says, in the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so everyone will praise your Heavenly Father. This is how we bring glory to God. This is how the earth is filled with the glory of God. When we do things, you know, it's not about works, I know, but when we don't do it, when we don't do things, the glory of the Lord isn't released. 1 John 1 says this, this is the message we heard from Jesus, and now declare to you, God is light, and there's no darkness in him. The rest of that says, so we are lying if we say we have fellowship with God, but go on living in spiritual darkness. We are not practicing the truth. But if you are living in the light, as God is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. This is what happens when we're living in the light. When we as a congregation are living in the light, the fellowship of God is so much easier. When we fellowship with one another. Jesus said in John 17, that I'll give them the glory so that they can be one. So when we're filled with light, it makes being in the church so much easier. We need to change the perception of the church in the world. The only way to change it is not to complain about it. It's to be different. Let it shine in you. Let the glory of God shine in you. When you get that negative thought towards somebody else in the church, go, let the glory of God, let the light of God shine on it. Probably he'll show you something in yourself that needs to be fixed. Not in the other person.
Come on.
Let that light shine. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are God's masterpiece. He created us in Christ, anew in Christ Jesus, so that we could do good things. The same word as before, that he planned for us long ago. God has a destiny over you. He doesn't just have a destiny over your pastor and his wife. He doesn't just have a destiny over maybe these people you watch or listen to, you know, on TV or podcasts or whatever. He has a destiny, a plan for every person in here. It doesn't matter where you come from, what you've been doing, what you did last night. It doesn't matter. He still has a destiny and a plan for you, and he wants you to carry it out through your life. Everyone in here is just as important as everyone else in here. The only one that's more important that's in here is Jesus.
Yeah. Come on.
When we do good things, when we live in obedience to Christ, the light of Christ is shining through us to fill the earth. Mark 16 says, verse 14 says, still later he appeared to the 11 disciples as they were eating together. He rebuked them for their stubborn unbelief because they refused to believe those who had seen him after he was raised from the dead. And then he told them, go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone. Anyone who believes in and is baptized will be saved, but anyone who refuses to believe will be condemned. These miraculous signs will accompany those who believe. They will get. I love how Tom White puts it. If you've heard it before, I don't know. He says it doesn't matter. The scripture says these signs will follow those who believe. Because I don't really care if anybody else believes. If I believe, then it's going to happen. These signs will follow those who believe. He says, these signs will follow those, these miraculous signs will accompany or follow those who believe. They will cast out demons in my name.
Yeah.
I've cast out demons. Anybody cast out demons? We should be. And it doesn't take some special anointed man or woman of power. It doesn't take a position. It doesn't take a title or an office. It takes belief.
Right.
These signs will accompany. How much glory will fill the earth if every believer starts casting out the demons that they find that are around them? And they're there. They're there. There's twice as many angels too, by the way. But they're there. And we have the power and the authority to cast them out. And that fills that spot with the glory of God. They will speak in new languages. I love this. I love when I hear stories, and you don't hear them all that much. I think we're going to be starting to hear them a little bit more. Like somebody like Surprise of Sotola, who speaks 14, I believe, languages that he was never taught, that the Holy Spirit gave him so that he could minister the gospel to the tribes that he was the ministers to. They will speak in new languages. I still try to speak Spanish, and it's still, you know, is hard. I suppose if I was asked to go to a Spanish-speaking country and live there, I would be, oh God, I need this supernatural, I need to speak in new languages by the power of God because I need to say what I need to say to people. Or fix their ears so they can understand. I think Spanish is a beautiful language, too, by the way. They were cast out demons. They were speaking new language. They will be able to handle snakes with safety. I don't know what to say about that. Because there are people that actually try to do that. I'm just saying, you know, Paul gave us a great example of that. It happened to Paul. He was collecting wood. A snake got on his hand. It bit him. They thought, oh, man, this guy's going to die. He must have done something bad because he escaped the ship. And now God's going to get him anyway. He shook it off, and he didn't die. Okay? Yeah. Please don't go handle snakes on purpose. If they drink anything poisonous, my wife stands on this. You know, buying healthy food without poison in it is really expensive. And we do it as much as possible. But sometimes we have to buy healthy food that probably does, food that probably does have chemicals and things on it. And she says, I'm standing on the word of God. If I have to eat this stuff, it's not going to do anything bad to me. Okay? So stand on the word for those things. It won't hurt them. They will be able to place their hands on the sick and they will be healed. These signs. This is how the Lord God is released. Listen. Lots of organizations can do lots of wonderful things in the earth. You don't have to be saved and full of the Holy Spirit to feed the hungry and clothe the naked. I mean, we should be doing that. We should definitely be doing that. But you don't have to be full of the Holy Spirit to do those things. But those organizations cannot lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. And they cannot cast out demons. I'm not saying that the people aren't believers and full of the Holy Spirit. Only the ecclesia. Only those who believe can do those things and fill the earth with God's glory. So, when the Lord Jesus had finished talking to them, he was taken up to heaven and sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. And the disciples went everywhere and preached, and the Lord worked through them, confirming what they said by miraculous signs. When we do this, we cause a disturbance. Let's look at what happened after that. Acts chapter 3, and 3 and 4. I'm just going to read a little bit of 4, but in 3, they went to the beautiful gate, remember? Peter and John went to the beautiful gate. There was a lame man there, and he said, oh, you know, I have something as well. I don't have any of that, but I do have something, and in the name of Jesus, rise and walk, right? And it caused a disturbance. It threw off things. That's the kind of thing we do. You know what? I want to encourage you. I remember there were times, and there were probably so many times, where sometimes you don't have enough money in the church treasury to do all the things you want to do. You know, help all the missionaries you want to help, give to all the things you want to do. But when that happens, what comes to my mind is, well, I may not have silver and gold, but I can still walk downtown. And I can still pray for the sick. And I can still prophesy over people. And it doesn't cost me anything to do that. You know? So there's nothing that should stop the church from doing ministry, ever. Okay? Yeah. Just that little thing, right? Okay, so chapter 4, verse 1. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, they were confronted by the priest and the captain of the temple guard and some Sadducees. These leaders were very disturbed that Peter and John were teaching people that through Jesus there is a resurrection from the dead. They were arrested then, since it was already evening, they put them in jail until morning, but many of the people who heard their message believed. So the number of believers that totaled about 5,000 men, not counting women and children. So they disturbed the religious system, but they also disturbed the whole deal. Like 5,000 men plus women and children were born again, saved on that day, and you can see in the book of Acts how things just continue to escalate, things continue to grow, because they just did a simple thing. All they did was say, they didn't have any money for this outreach program. They just said, rise and walk. That's all they did. They just obeyed what the Holy Spirit told them to do. They just believed what Jesus said. These signs will follow those who believe. And just by being obedient and realizing they carried something in them that mattered more than money, they disturbed the whole deal. And they disturbed the religious system. Paul and Silas disturbed it too. Acts 17, not finding them there, they took them before the council. This is Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas have caused trouble all over the world, they shouted. And now they're disturbing our city too. You know what? That's what I want to be said. I don't mean by just ordinary people, but I mean by the systems, by the religious system, by the people that are living in darkness and trying to promote the darkness. I want them to be upset with me because I disturbed what they were trying to do. You know, it's not really the people so much as it's the principalities and powers and rulers. That's where we get to start. I think I'm going to talk about that in a second. So what have they done to disturb the religious system that they had set up? Sometimes it's the religious systems that need to be disturbed. Another way we can cause disturbance is to intercede on behalf of our neighborhoods. When you come together to pray, please don't just pray for Sally's ankle and, you know, all the stuff that's troubling us, right? Please don't just pray for that. That's not what prayer is all about. Yeah, it's for that. But it's to deal with what is going on. It's to take the prophetic word of the Lord and say, what's hindering this from happening? What principalities and powers and rulers in the heavens are hindering us from being the powerful group of people that we are? We're awesome. We're filled with the glory of God. We're filled with the light of Christ. The fire has come down and baptized us. And we've got everything we need to turn everything upside down. Like Paul and Silas and Peter and John. How come everything's not upside down yet? Well, I think a lot of times it's because we haven't dealt with the principalities and powers and rulers. In 2 Corinthians, verse 10, or chapter 10, Paul was talking, writing to the Corinthian church. You've heard this verse before, and maybe you haven't heard it this way. You may have. It says, he's saying to them, we are human. We, meaning, and this is how I interpret Paul and his apostolic team, right? The guys that he was with, that he was ministering with. So we are human, but we do not, and read this whole thing to understand it. But we don't wage war as humans do. This is so important. I think the church gets caught up in waging war the way humans do too often. And we forget about the power that we have that actually deals with the stuff behind what humans do. He says, we use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. Think about this now. Now, as I heard this taught, It was very personal. I'm supposed to pull down strongholds, and I'm supposed to take my thoughts captive. That is not what this says. I'm not saying we shouldn't do that. Yeah, we've got bad thoughts taken captive, for goodness sake. That's not what this says, though. This says that there was a group of ministers that was going to pull down strongholds in Corinth and destroy obstacles, false arguments, capture rebellious thoughts, and teach them to obey Christ. He was saying, this is what we're going to do in the heavens. Paul was the one who told us to deal with principalities and powers and rulers. And then he says, and after you have become fully obedient, we will punish everyone who remains disobedient. And then we're going to go in, and we're going to deal with it on the ground level. And we're going to work things out. We're going to help things work out, right? When we stand full of the Holy Spirit as a group of people in a region, in a community, we can shine the light of Christ so well. We have everything we need to do it. All we have to do is allow it to shine through us. And the darkness has to flee. Please don't be afraid of the darkness. Please don't be afraid of whatever, you know, government things are going on locally or federally or even across the world. Don't be afraid of that. Don't be afraid of Hollywood. For goodness sake, don't be afraid of Hollywood. We have nothing to fear as people of God, because greater is He that's in us than He that's in the world. Don't be afraid of the future, whatever that holds.
Yeah.
Because greater is He that's in us than He that's in the world. We've been Christ. Our job is to fill the earth with the knowledge of the glory of God. And we have everything we need to do. Amen?
Amen.
So, I want to pray again, similar to what we prayed earlier, that the fire of God would fall on us and light us up. And I want you to imagine, even, you being a very brittle sacrifice, ready to be burned up. You know, a piece of wood that's been around for a while. Like, you know, when I want to get a fire started in my fireplace, I get that old lath that I took off. We did a reconstruction. You know, the plaster lath, that lath, that stuff burns like crazy. And it will heat up in a hot second. So, imagine yourself being something like that, and then asking the fire of God to fall on you and to come and consume you so that you can fill your family, your workplace, your community, your neighborhood with the knowledge of the glory of God. It's so awesome, and they need it. And they need us to be the light of the world that has called us to be, a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. You cannot be hidden. You cannot be hidden. Let's say that. I am the light of the world. I'm a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. Amen. Can we stand up? I like what they asked you to do before. You know, well, however you want to do it. You know, position yourself. Imagine yourself the sacrifice, because we're called to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. But imagine yourself a living sacrifice that's just so ready to be burned up, so ready for the fire of God to fall on you, that you will burn and burn and burn brightly and hotly, so that the people around you, and so not only you will be full of the glory of God, but the people around you, your co-workers, your family members, your neighbors, the people you run into in the market, will be aware of the glory of God, will be full of the knowledge and awareness. Darkness isn't so powerful. God is powerful. So, Father, we ask again, let your fire fall. Holy Spirit, come. Consume us. That we would be fires burning brightly. That the world around us would be full of the knowledge of the glory of God because you're burning so brightly within us. That we wouldn't be afraid to prophesy, that we wouldn't be afraid to cast out a demon, that we wouldn't be afraid of laying hands on the sick, that we wouldn't be afraid to reach out in love to somebody who maybe, you know, we might otherwise be afraid of. That we wouldn't be afraid of our job, our bosses, the government, we wouldn't be afraid of.